A continuación, iniciaremos el desarrollo del panel número 1, los nuevos esquemas de pagos internacionales, bajo la moderación del doctor Miguel Díaz Díaz. Por favor, invitamos a los integrantes del panel a tomar su lugar.
Muchas gracias, señor gobernador, y muchas gracias a todos nuestros invitados a este primer seminario técnico en el contexto del 25 aniversario de la autonomía del Banco de México. En atención a nuestras destacadas panelistas, llevaremos a cabo esta sesión en inglés, aunque contamos con equipos de traducción simultánea. En este momento voy a dar un par de segundos para que puedan encender sus dispositivos. This first panel is intended to provide the audience with a general vision of the payment ecosystem in the near future, considering experiences from around the world and from firms that are relative newcomers into the ecosystem. To provide a clear context for this discussion, I will provide a brief introduction consisting on Banco de México's vision and some general views that we consider are of the essence to fulfill our mandate of promoting the well-functioning of the payment systems. Then, our two panelists will each share with us their firm's vision looking forward regarding payment services. After this broad overview, we will dialogue regarding certain key elements on how to approach these visions. And finally, we will close the panel with a round of questions from the audience. Staff members will be around the room receiving your written questions. Now, I will go right into the vision of payment systems from Banco de México. Based on our payments mandate, we have developed a specific vision in this respect. Our objective is that every Mexican is able to send and receive electronic payments in a near transparent fashion. To make this goal even more tangible, our objective is that every Mexican, regardless of their cultural, educational, or economic background, will be able to go to the corner store and electronically pay without being bothered by complicated schemes, and all of these under an umbrella of safety, efficiency, and trust. This vision's desirability rests on the fact that electronic payments are a means to enable welfare-enhancing and value-added products and services, both from a commercial perspective and from a financial point of view. Electronic payments generate information that becomes the stepping stone of true financial inclusion. And through these, they are key to generating economic growth based on more advanced financial services. Having an account is not enough to be considered financially included, because most of the benefits of financial inclusion are achieved through the use and not just by holding such accounts. In line with this, Banco de México has worked through the years in pursuit of its mandate. We have issued regulations that opened up and leveled the playing fields on the payments realm so that new entities can offer better services to as many Mexicans as possible. Such is the case of access to pay by non-bank regulated financial entities, the creation of electronic payment fund institutions, and adjustment to the card rules that allow for new service providers to come into the game. We also established the infrastructure that allows any financial institution to access broad existing networks, but we still need to work further to get closer to our vision. We have to approach the problem with a wide perspective, one that sees abroad for lessons learned and that considers the view of players that did not exist when the payments infrastructure was developed. Banco de México's view has a place for any participant that can improve upon and provide a better or different service in favor of users. We envision an ecosystem that is wide enough to provide opportunities for everyone and that has the characteristic that allows each participant to fully obtain the benefits of their competitive advantages, be this a network externality, a simple and robust user experience, and integration of services for the customer, the safekeeping of funds, and the trust of clients with their financial resources. We perceive that technology has pushed forward a global paradigm shift in the payments realm, and it is our responsibility as a central bank to understand the new conditions by approaching all parties with relevant perspectives on the matter. It is time to build new infrastructure consistent with the new technological reality, one that is fully interoperable and that is flexible enough to support different business cases. We operate in an environment in which users are already familiar with digital services such as email, messaging, and in general with operating through their smartphones. Financial institutions, on their side, have been developing more agile responses to technological changes and are ready to provide secure services for much larger sets of customers. Newcomer firms have the know-how on reaching customers and providing unique integrated service experiences. And financial authorities are ready to identify risks and regulate to mitigate them and to protect users. The final ingredient on which we have to work on is how to integrate these capabilities and go forward with it. In line with these conditions and goals, we have two extraordinary representatives of the paradigm change we are observing throughout the world. Global executives of two of the most iconic technological firms will share with us their visions and the steps each has taken in different jurisdictions to bring access to financially excluded populations. First, let me introduce Uzma Makdoumi. She is currently head of payment partnerships at Google, where she helped launch Google Pay internationally in multiple markets. She now leads new business development initiatives for consumer payments globally, working with banks, payment networks, regulators, and financial technology companies to incubate new use cases to support customers and merchants. Prior to Google, Uzma was leading commercialization for Visa Digital and was also one of the early product managers for mobile at Yahoo, where she managed their first revenue-generating mobile products. She has also been a consultant at McKinsey, advising high-tech companies in the areas of strategy, growth, and acquisition, and was an engineer at Bose Corporation, working directly for the founder and CEO, Dr. Amar Bose. Uzma double majored in electrical engineering and computer science and management science from MIT, and holds an MBA from Stanford Graduate School of Business. She is also a certified leadership and executive coach and advisory board member for the Rise Up for Money 2020 US to empower women leaders in payments and the startup advisors. Thank you very much for being here, Uzma. We're also greatly honored by the presence of Lina Im. She is the global head of payments policy team at Facebook. In this capacity, she works with product partnerships, legal, and other cross-functional teams across the Facebook family of apps to drive policy development in the payments space. She and her team also work with policymakers, civil society, peer companies, and other policy stakeholders on payment policy issues. Prior to Facebook, she was at the US Consumer Financial Protection Bureau, where she focused on emerging payments policy, consumer education, and behavioral economics. In this role, she was involved in the development of policies like the US prepaid card rule and understanding credit card repayment behaviors. Before joining the CFPB, she worked on financial inclusion, education, and savings products in the US and abroad. She began her career as an educator in low-income communities, where she saw the effects of unbanked and underbanked infrastructures. Lina was also a Fulbright scholar in Indonesia and received her BA in political science and a master in public policy from the University of California, Berkeley. So now I will give the floor to Uzma for her presentation on Google's vision on payments.
Thank you, Miguel. Can you all see me? I guess you can. Let me just come a little forward here. Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. Thank you for having me here, Governor Alejandro and Miguel and everyone else. Very excited to be here at the 25th anniversary event. So I wanted to take this opportunity to talk to you about what Google has done in the world of payments and financial services, and how it has partnered with governments and the banking sectors and other companies around the world, and what our vision is for the future. So let me start by asking, what is the greatest invention? You know, some might say it's a bicycle. Others would say air conditioning, especially at this time of the year. I'd like to make a pitch for the humble smartphone, because it is likely the device that most of humanity will possess. Today, there are about 4 billion users on the internet, and another 1 billion coming online soon over the next few years. And most of them will possess a smartphone. And let's think about the smartphone for a minute. Today, the smartphone has more computing power than NASA had in 1969 when they put the first man on the moon. And the smartphone is a portal to more information than the largest library in the world. Right? So let's think about that. The smartphone, like most of humanity, will then have access to more computing power and more knowledge than the most powerful organizations had on Earth just 50 years ago. Right? Today, there are over 1 billion users around the world with active Google accounts, right? And 90% of smartphone users in Mexico alone are Android users, who naturally then have a Google account as well. So there are a lot of users here with a smartphone, and smartphones are really changing user behavior. So as we think about trends around the world, especially on mobile because of the smartphone, you see that users are now expecting to see a lot of information on their phones, right? Previously, we used to carry calendars and cameras, and now it's all consolidated into one device. The offline world and online world are merging. You've got like online stores that are buying up physical stores, and you've got physical stores that are going online. And then many countries are also trying to go digital in many ways. The biggest opportunity we see today, or one of the biggest at least, I would say, is applying technology and mobile technology to the world of money. That's moving money, saving money, and leveraging money for growth, right? A lot of countries will see outsized impact when they move their economies, or the formal economies, to digital. However, in today's smartphone-enabled, always-connected world, payments just, or at least the formal payment system, is just not working for everybody, right? Younger users in particular are often feel that traditional banking systems are antiquated for them. About 48% of millennials in the US want to move to a digital-only bank. About 1 in 3 millennials in the US are considering switching their banks in the next 90 days, right? Moreover, the formal financial system doesn't really connect with everybody, right? There are about 2.5 billion adults in the world today who are unbanked or underbanked, 2.5 billion. And the majority of those are women, right? Their lack of access, you know, impacts their children, their societies at large, businesses around them. So we believe that technology needs to be applied and deployed at large scale to help solve some of these real-world problems, to help move the economies forward. Earlier this year, our CEO presented at our annual developer conference and pitched a more helpful Google for everyone, right? Building for everyone is part of a core philosophy for Google. Because we believe that, you know, we can build better products and services when everyone is invited in. Because Google is open source, right? Android is open source. You have 2.5 billion Android devices in the world today that are made by over 1,300 different companies. So we invite everyone in, we work with an open ecosystem. And because we are an open ecosystem, participating with other players in the ecosystem, you have over a million apps on the Google Play Store, right? It took a global community to come together to put a smartphone in the hands of everyone. And we believe that same global community needs to come together again to help digitize economies. So there's a popular but deeply mistaken belief that tech companies and banks are rivals. We don't believe that at all, because we at Google believe that when we work together with banks, we can actually build better products for everyone, right, as partners. So we believe in partnering with banks to bring our joint assets together to build products for all types of consumers and merchants. So whether it's millennials, or whether it's the underbanked, or whether it's merchants, small businesses, large or small, we believe we can build better products together. And we believe that, you know, and we can work with governments to help, as governments are trying to move societies from cash to digital and from the informal economy to the formal economy. And we've actually demonstrated this. For example, in India, as India was trying to move from a cash-heavy society to a more digital economy, we actually worked with the government and with the financial services industry to build sort of a more digital payments platform. And we launched a very simple payment app in the market that is widely used now by both consumers and merchants alike. So let me start by talking about sort of the models that we've seen emerging in the world today, where economies have tried to move from sort of cash heavy to more digital. So you've got sort of the China model, and you've got what I call the India model. So if you think about the China model, just a few years ago, China was a very cash heavy economy. And there emerged two tech companies that then became very dominant payment players in the market and are still very dominant there today and now expanding globally. And these started out as sort of stored value wallets where consumers could add value to these wallets, and then they built up merchant acceptance. And payments took place outside of the banking system, outside of regulator purview. And now these wallets have been dominating, and regulators are, and banks are stepping in to figure out how they recover from that position. The other model that we have seen and are participating in is the model in India, where we built a simple app on top of the unified payment system, which is India's real-time payment system, right? So now, Google user or any other tech company user or, you know, bank user can push payments from one bank account in near real time and at a very low cost to another bank account. So whether it's peer-to-peer or from a person to a merchant. So as I said, we built an app as well to take advantage of this unified payment system. And that has enabled consumers to have more of a conversational type of experience with the entities that they want to pay. And moving along, what we've seen is that a rising tide lifts all boats. So when we launched, and when the government launched this unified payment interface, and Google Pay launched, and other technology providers also launched on top of the government's unified payment interface scheme, the transactions on that system rose 43 times over the last 18 to 20 months. So if you see the gray bars here below, they indicate what the traffic used to be before some of these, before the unified payment interface scheme came about. And after we launched, we've seen transactions on that interbank national rails skyrocket. And this just indicates that if you focus on the green bars, that indicates the transaction growth on UPI, Unified Payment Interface. You can see that other transactions are also increasing, right? Card transactions, mobile banking, et cetera, those are organic growth. But the green indicates the growth on top of these interbank rails, which we believe is a lot of the cash displacement that the Indian government was after. And now you can see that these bank-to-bank transfers are greater in volume than, you know, wallet transactions and card transactions. And initially, we thought that perhaps such digital payments would be applicable to some of the larger, you know, metros and cities, but may not necessarily be applicable to other parts of the country where we really wanted to target financial inclusion. However, we were pleasantly surprised that a simple scheme like this enabled, you know, about 2 out of 3 transactions and users to be outside of the top metros. So truly, this national rail scheme that we worked on with governments and banks has enabled financial inclusion in India, where there are users from about 300,000 villages and cities using this scheme instead of cash. And now, you know, we are seeing that a number of countries around the world are looking to build up, you know, or digitize their economies using real-time payment rails, which Mexico already has in place today in the form of SPEI. So we are being approached by a number of different countries and governments and regulators, and we are sharing our learnings from our experience in India and other markets with them as they try to move their economies into the next era. So enough about numbers. Let me end with a story of a real person. This is Vijay Babu. He owns a small laundry shop in Bangalore, right? He can't read or write and has historically been collecting payments in cash and managing that cash and dealing with the overhead of that and dealing with potential theft at times. He wanted to start targeting some of the digital smartphone savvy millennials and cater to those. So his daughter helped him set up Google Pay on his very cheap Android smartphone, and he has a QR code that goes along with it. And because of Google Pay now, he is able to manage his transactions, receive payments remotely, and even build relationships with his customers through the Google Chat app, and get paid pretty much instantly. So he's been very excited about this. And his success is just one example of what can happen when governments, you know, banks, financial services, and tech companies come together. So together, we can and absolutely must empower billions more like him. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Uzma.
Oh, yeah.
Sorry. Thank you very much, Uzma. Please, Lina.
Thank you again for inviting us to this event, Miguel, and thank you everyone for joining today. I'm gonna talk through a little bit about why payments is an important tool for Facebook and really our vision for how we think it could really help our ecosystem and help our users. And our vision also for how this has to be a partnerships-based model. It cannot be tech companies alone. And as Uzma said, we really believe that there are the baseline for how we move this forward is through partnerships with the existing financial ecosystem. So these are some of the topics I'm gonna run through. I'm gonna jump right in. So when we think about payments, we think about it as a baseline tool for us. And it's important for us because there are so many SMEs on our platforms. And really, like, our goal is to continue to build that community and expand their access to new tools as they grow their businesses. In most economies, as you all know better than I do, the small, medium-sized businesses are really the engines that drive economic growth, and we want to be able to provide those players with tools that really help them grow. So that's kind of our vision when we think about payments writ large. Of course, there are a lot of other tools that we really want to provide our users. So I'll go in through some of the other ones, but this is really our guiding star. I'm going to start with a short video to actually demonstrate how SMEs use our platforms and the roles, the benefits that they see in some of the tools that we provide. I hope this works.
For 10 years, I worked as a counselor at Camp Hill Maximum State Security Prison. It was just a particularly bad day. I needed some sort of outlet. I stopped at a craft store. That was the turning point. I take pieces of wire and sheet metal and make them into a wearable piece of art that I can sell in my shop on Facebook. This is Edders, PA, population 940. Being a small business in a rural area, Facebook really makes it a small world. I've shipped things all the way across the earth and the money gets automatically deposited into my bank account. Payments come in very quickly. Facebook just makes everything so much easier. It took me a long time to be able to find what I wanted to do with my life, turning that hobby into more of a business. And without Facebook, I wouldn't be able to be the creator I am.
I love this story because of three things. One, it's someone in a rural place in US, and oftentimes when people think about rural places, they actually don't think about the US, but it's about someone in a rural area in the US who's really able to jumpstart a new economic life for them using an online tool, digital tool. Second, she points out the importance of banks, how the money is deposited directly into her bank account, and I think that also points out how existing infrastructures and existing products that you all have developed already are important in this entire ecosystem. Third, she talks about being able to ship and sell cross borders. And when we think about micro SMEs to SMEs, we really want to be able to help them sell cross borders to grow their businesses. And we can do that by providing them tools. We do not come up with the ideas like they come up with, but we try to think through how can we make them their lives easier as they try to move their businesses forward. So how do we envision commerce and payments on all of our platforms? There are many, many different ways, and I'm going to quickly kind of tick through them. So there's obviously shopping when you think about commerce, shopping on Instagram and Facebook, and then there's our marketplace product. There's also messaging on commerce via Messenger, which I think is actually an important tool. So an example of that is actually in Thailand. We found that through a lot of user research, we found that a lot of Thai SMEs were selling on Messenger. So there are countries that are Messenger first or WhatsApp first, and really Thailand, the tool that they use is Facebook Messenger. They don't use WhatsApp at the levels that they do in Mexico, for instance. And we found that Thai SMEs were selling through Messenger, and there would be a break in their interaction with their sellers. So let's say I'm buying a dress from seller A, where they would say, okay, please send me your money. And the buyer would go to an ATM, send a payment through an ATM network, come back to Messenger, take a picture of their ATM receipt and say, I've paid you. And then the seller would send them the dress or whatever it might be. That led to a lot of drop sales. That was also very cumbersome for buyers and sellers. And what we kept hearing from the Thai marketplace was, is there a way Facebook could build a tool to make that transaction easier? We're very good at building tools and thinking about platforms. Banks and financial institutions are actually much better than us in thinking about what's the right mechanism for that. So in Thailand, what we did is we partnered with local banks that actually built an invoicing and payment system, and they built that bot on top of the Messenger platform, and now Thai SMEs are actually able to invoice their buyers through Messenger and then get paid through their bank rails directly into their bank account. So again, that's an example of how we really think about the ecosystem. We may spot the issues in the digital economy, we may spot the issues in certain messaging services, but we need the partnerships to really carry out that product vision and serve our users. A few other points is P2P payments. In the US, we do have a debit-based P2P payment. And the US, the behavior is very different, right? We see a lot of people using that tool to, you know, split dinners that they've had with friends or roommates to split utility costs or rent. So we are seeing very different behaviors in how people both use the products, but really the need that people see in their markets. And the last one I really want to touch on are donations. So through some of our payments products, we have both a donations product and a fundraising product. In my mind, those are very exciting because they've almost democratized fundraising. So instead of having to pay a third party to run a campaign for you, or having to figure out how do I collect donations in cash, then mail it in to an entity, you can now actually start those campaigns on your own on Facebook. And really, there are so many stories about small nonprofits that are getting a lot of donations through these products because now their users that are dispersed throughout the world are able to start those campaigns on their behalf. There are many principles as we think through these products, right? As Uzma pointed out, there are many stakeholders from governments to existing financial institutions, and we really try to think about that entire ecosystem as we think about principles. And really, the number one is that partnerships are critical. We cannot build these products, we cannot go into these markets, we cannot really like fulfill kind of our vision and our partners' visions for what we could do in the digital economy without them. So whether those partners are banks, digital wallets, or even governments, partnerships are really, really important for us. The second is an open and inclusive model. We really feel like the more we can bring onto the system, the more products that we can develop, the more inclusive we could be, it really fuels the third point, increasing financial access. And we can't do that alone, and we know that, and these principles are really what guide our products and our approach to the payment space. And a few necessary factors that go along with that, that we've seen help as we've been kind of working around the world. First, again, is collaboration, whether that's with regulators, policymakers, civil society, existing financial ecosystems. Second are clear rules. So really thinking about, I don't think there is this myth that tech companies are constantly trying to evade rules. I actually think what we're after is clear rules and clear regulations and really an enabling regulatory environment. So there are models where wallets are built up and regulators chase them after the fact, or there are models where you can partner with existing financial ecosystems, and we really feel like that second model is more conducive to growth and a more safe environment for our users. And that leads into the next one, a safe and simple consumer experience. We are very good at the simple consumer experiences and the safe consumer experiences, but obviously in the financial space, there are lots of other consumer protection issues to consider, financial crime issues to consider. So really developing that space is very important to us. And that leads into security and standards, obviously. And the last one is sustainability. I think that goes back to collaboration and the importance of partnerships. For these products to sustain, we need robust regulatory environments, we need robust partnerships. We just need an ecosystem that actually can react to changing environments in a very responsible way, but that still allows innovation to flourish. And again, these are some of our partners from around the world. And as you see, we can't do this on our own, and we have no misconceptions that we can do this on our own. So that's really our overall vision.
Thank you very much, Lina. So thank you very much for sharing with us the vision of your firms. It was really very enlightening. And I think we clarified a very important question that probably is in the mind of most of our guests regarding your take on how we should go forward on this, regarding in specific the collaboration of tech firms and financial institutions. But I would like to go a little bit more in depth in that question. And I would like to ask you both, how do you envision in particular, or with a very specific example, how can we get a win-win-win solution in which the customer gets a better service, the financial industry gets a profit-generating service, and then the tech industry also get a profit-generating service?
Sure, maybe I can start here.
So as I referred to earlier, I mean, our objective is to partner with the financial ecosystem. We are good at technology, but we are not good at banking. I mean, that's not our forte, and especially we build platforms that are scalable globally. So, and banking is sort of very localized, right, with local regulators. So in our minds, we have to partner with the existing ecosystem. We have to partner with the governments. We have to partner with the financial institutions. And we have to partner with merchants to enable a win-win for everyone. The way we see it, you know, for merchants, in order to really displace cash, so if we're talking about sort of moving from informal to formal, from cash to digital, et cetera, you need both, you know, the consumers to want to use digital payments and for merchants to want to accept digital payments, right? And when you do that, banks benefit because they're actually able to see the transaction, which they otherwise wouldn't have been able to see if it was conducted in cash only. So for consumers to want to use digital payments, it has to be simple and easy to use. It has to be safe for them and secure. It's got to be able to enable payments pretty quickly. And it's got to be something that everyone can use, right? We talk about building Android for everyone. We talk about building Google products for everyone. We want, you know, to truly have financial inclusion, everyone should be able to use the product. And that's what banks want, that's what governments want. You mentioned the vision is for every Mexican to pay and be able to send and receive money. For merchants, right, it is the way to displace cash is going to be for them to be able to accept payments easily and cheaply, right? We talked about the example of the laundry shop owner, right? For him to, you know, accept something other than cash, historically would have been pretty expensive to get an expensive POS terminal and then have to wait to reconcile his receipts and to get paid. So what merchants are looking for, especially small and medium-sized merchants who are the backbone of most economies, they're looking to get paid quickly and cheaply. And the way they're going to displace cash is by processing payments that way. Because there's a perception for merchants that cash is free. But it's not really, because think about the overhead of counting your cash, think about the overhead of securing that cash. So in order to enable these, right, we need to make sure that there are, it's easy for consumers to open digital products or digital financial products like bank accounts, so sort of low KYC bank accounts that can be quickly opened and be useful. As you mentioned, Miguel, financial inclusion is not just about people having a bank account, but actually making it useful for them so that they start using it by making these payments and by receiving payments easily and quickly. So you need to have, you know, low KYC accounts. You need to have internet access. You need to have availability of devices that they can use to make payments. For merchants, it's again the ability to make payments easily and quick, receive payments easily and quickly without having heavy infrastructure. And without having to worry about, oh my God, what am I going to do about taxes, right? So those things have to be put in place. And when they are put in place, then banks benefit because banks are able to see transactions go through the system. They're able to build credit histories on both merchants and consumers and be able to then upsell them financial services like loans and mortgages and other things that those might want. So it's really a win-win for everyone. If you have all of these pillars in place for the economy to move away from cash.
Yeah, and I want to echo a lot of what Uzma said. I think there is the enabling kind of policy and regulatory environment, and much like Miguel said, you know, Mexico and the Central Bank of Mexico have been thinking about that enabling environment. What are the enabling tools? And then there are enabling infrastructure that's in place and new infrastructure that may be coming about. So that's kind of the banking sector and all the tools that you all have built. And then there's the demand side. So what do individuals and merchants want? How can we actually help them enter more of the digital economy, not just through brick and mortar, not just at brick and mortar stores, but really like if there are businesses that are brick and mortar that want to digitize, how does that move forward? So I think it's everything from, you know, kind of tiered KYC systems in the regulated, in the regulatory sphere, modernized KYC when we think about even video KYC, and then it's all the different products that are already in the market. And really, like, our role as Facebook is to think as a platform how we connect all those pieces together. And that's, I think, where we really provide the value. We're not the ones that are going to be owning the accounts or, you know, being the bank, but we really are the connector as a platform.
So, Lina, let me ask you a question. So, coming from probably one of the biggest or the biggest social network around, so you have lots of digital services and lots of functionality that you have introduced into the platform, and it has been uptaken by people relatively fast. So when we're talking about this new financial services being provided through these platforms that were not usually used for that in the past, do you envision that this speed in terms of adoption of these new financial services be the same as with other digital services, or do you envision any like different factor when you're talking about resources of the people?
Well, we would love the speed to be the same. I think there are several very important factors. First of all, the financial ecosystem isn't global, really. Our platform may be global, but jurisdictions, you know, in financial services are country by country. So we still have to figure out, like, who are the right partners in each country? What are the right enabling environments that exist in each country? So I think just by that baseline alone, payments and kind of financial services is something that takes time and should, because it involves people's money and involves an ecosystem. So I would say that primary factor in not just the regulations in each jurisdiction, but really understanding all of the local behaviors and what's the right payment tool to really help the local environment, I think, is another thing. So there can't be a global kind of norm for a lot of this.
You mentioned trust. So probably this is one of the elements in which the collaboration is really necessary. So that.
Yep. Definitely. I think, you know, there is a lot of trust that we as a company need to continue to build in every ecosystem. And also, like, there are banks and other, you know, financial service providers that have already a lot of trust in each system. And I think that's why, to your point, the partnerships are key, is because we can kind of augment each other's work there.
Usma, so we talk like relatively simple about the simple integration between tech firms and financial institutions. But then again, when you see how things have worked in the past, it is not clear that it is so easy. Nowadays, new elements like open banking and APIs have come to the game. What do you think about this? And do you think these are a good solution in terms of allowing this general integration between banks and fintech firms?
Yeah. So there is definitely a wave of sort of open banking around the world, and I would say what we've seen in India is also another example of open banking. I mean, open banking essentially, in my mind, is really allowing the bank account to do more, right? To create, you know, APIs that enable the bank account to be more useful to the user. And we saw that in India, where consumers are now able to send money to merchants or to peers using their bank account. So it's direct bank-to-bank account integration. And that we've seen, as I mentioned earlier, transactions on the interbank rails because of this have skyrocketed. And we are seeing that same phenomenon around the world with Europe. You know, open banking is an essential part of the PSD2 regulation. But even outside of sort of regulation, we are seeing governments around the world looking at, you know, the China model and looking at the India model and wanting to make digital payments happen through the existing banking infrastructure, which has worked well, and through the regulators. And so we are seeing a number of regulators around the world wanting to help banks make the banking account more inclusive, build something for all, for merchants and for consumers. And we're seeing a lot of governments that don't have existing interbank real-time rails like SPAY also start to develop those. So, so we feel like there is a big movement to make the bank account not just a place to hold deposits, but also to be able to send and receive payments quickly. And to come back to your earlier point about how tech firms work with that, as I showed earlier, in India, what we have done is we have partnered with banks such that a Google user could use their Google Pay app and say, move my money from my bank account A to that one's bank account B. And that money movement is actually happening from bank account to bank account. The Google Pay app is simply sort of the user interface that enables users to be able to send instruction to their bank to move and receive money. So that's how we've partnered together. We provide the technology infrastructure. Banks provide sort of the holding and the infrastructure of connecting with the interbank rails. And that's been a model that's been successful. And we you know, hope to replicate that in other markets that want the same.
So let me try to get just a one-liner from each of you in terms of, so both your companies have had lots of experiences around the world in terms of allowing for lots of people to gain access to payments and then through that to gain financial inclusion, real financial inclusion. So if you had to summarize, like in just like the most important element that you have seen elsewhere, what would it be? What is the most important element that links the payments with the financial inclusion?
I would say, can I make it two sentences, or will you?
Yes, of course.
You can take one of mine if you want.
I would say it's understanding user behavior and understanding the ecosystem, because that has to happen. Like, we will never and can't go in just thinking, this is the model that's worked elsewhere, this is the type of partnerships that's worked elsewhere, and transplant that. We really have to understand the local context. That was more than two sentences.
That's great. That's great. We have received lots of questions, so I will start like mixing questions from the public. So one is basically asking, like, from your point of view. So we have Usma. You explained a little bit about the different models in China and in India, and when you see the ecosystem in Mexico, what do you think? So, what do you think are the main characteristics in Mexico, and how is the Mexican system similar or different from China and India?
Sure, that's a good question. So, what we have observed in Mexico is that the regulator, obviously, I'm sitting with you all. We've seen that you are more progressive than many markets, right? And in fact, you already have Spay rails, which is a huge asset, because there are many countries around the world that do not have interbank rails that are starting to contemplate it. You've already heard about the US also made an announcement about FedNow, you know, to be out in a couple of years. So you already have the interbank rails in the form of Spay. You're already contemplating using that to make payments simple and easy through Kodi and beyond. In addition, you know, the president has made it very clear that financial inclusion and social and digital inclusion is part of his agenda. So that's also very helpful overall. And I think these two together will help propel the market forward as everyone in the ecosystem tries to work together to move towards a model where transactions are taking place, right, digitally, but they're also taking place in a way that you can regulate and you can oversee, and that feels a lot more like the India model, because it's going to be bank-to-bank transfers or entity-to-entity transactions that are connected through Spay, which you're regulating.
Let me share another question, which is a little bit more technical. So someone from the audience is asking if you could compare and contrast the European model with PSD2 with the UPI model in India, and whether you have a preferred way forward.
Board Member Nelson?
Yeah, you should, yeah, since you all have...
So I would just say that in Europe, we are seeing PSD2 as sort of driving or open banking, but it's sort of regulator-led, right? So it's banks will innovate when either they feel the need to innovate and or there's a mandate to regulate. And in many markets in Europe, regulation is there, so the banks are going to comply or are working towards complying with regulation to create open banking. So, you know, account information as well as payment initiation type of APIs are being built out by banks in response to regulation. In other markets, it's been a combination where banks are realizing that they need to move forward because I guess the next wave of internet users is mobile first or in many cases mobile only. And so they need to move their existing models to allow for these mobile first, mobile only type of users who want digital experiences and may not necessarily want to go into branches in all cases or may want to be able to do more with their bank account. And so we are seeing in many markets, banks are trying to innovate and regulators are coming along for the ride as well. And so we are seeing both of these models. And I think it's not to say that one is better than the other. It's, you know, how do economies move forward together with banks, regardless of whether it was the regulator who initiated or whether it was the banks who initiated the innovation. What matters is the end result of the innovation that's available that enables everyone in the economy to be included.
The success of any payment system, as in any social network, depends on the size and the strength of the network. So based on that, so do you believe that this might lead towards a global payment system infrastructure? Lina?
I think at the end of the day, I think because payments are still very local, while we could serve as a global platform, we will still need all the local kind of relationships. So I think part of our strength is coming from understanding how different markets have functioned, understanding how in different markets banks and others have partnered with us. But at the end of the day, since any financial kind of product and interactions are so local, I think there is, I don't think you could call it a truly global platform kind of that provides one single kind of product. Mm.
One delicate question that I also think is in everyone's mind is there's a delicate balance between privacy and security and the use of personal information for providing different services. And a clear example of this trade-off is when you basically know your client, you might know when he's actually doing the transaction as opposed to some fraudster that has taken control of the accounts. But then again, there's this concern by the people on how their personal information is used. So what do you think should be the principles that should guide our way forward in terms of managing this personal information? So let me ask this question to both of you guys.
So I can start. For us, I mean, the core of our business relies on user trust. Right? Without user trust, we don't have users, and therefore we don't have a business. And what we believe is that we must give users transparency, control, and choice of how their data is used and collected and what services they might use. So we are very clear about that. Users know exactly. We want to be as transparent as possible in terms of what we are collecting from users and giving them the option to turn it on or off. For example, right, in Maps data, right, some of our products rely on users providing information. So we ask users if they want to turn on location services so that we can help them in Maps to get from their current location to the location of their choice. And if they share that information, we can also sort of aggregate users' information anonymously to provide traffic information and journey times. So there are some cases where our services, products and services become more valuable when we have user data because it becomes valuable to the user. But we are very clear that we do not use user data at all without user consent, and we never sell users' data. So, you know, that is how we have run our business, and that's how we intend to run our business going forward.
The same, trust is so important to us, and it's something that we need to continue to earn and build with our users, and really, like, that is exactly the approach.
Good. So, Lina, from your perspective, and this is another question from the audience, which is the main reason of the exponential growth in payments in countries such as China?
I think it's the simple user experience and really the penetration that some of these products have been able to have on the merchant side. It's really providing both on the consumer side a reason to continue to adopt these tools, and on the merchant side, it's this parallel growth on the demand and supply sides that have been pretty, you know, pretty astounding to watch. So I would say it's really thinking about the entire ecosystem of interactions and having that growth. And obviously, you know, they're very, distinct products.
Mm. Usma, so of course, you're leveraging a lot of people's knowledge in terms of how to use their phones and so on in order to get them in the payments band, if you wish. What is the most important element that customers have to know in terms of jumping from this knowing how to use their smartphones to actually knowing how to use the financial system? What are the main elements that you leverage on in terms of bringing all these people that probably don't have higher levels of education and so on? How do you leverage this knowledge?
It's really interesting how people have around the world have adopted smartphone usage. I talked about the fact that there are about 2.5 billion Android devices in the world today, and many of them are being used by people who are not fully literate. But somehow there's something, I would say, almost magical, right, about the device where, users have moved from just using it to place phone calls to being able to, you know, scroll their screens with their fingers and being able to access the internet and being able to do a lot with it. I myself have seen users in many, emerging and growing economies using smartphones without actually being able to read or write. And so I think for us, we believe it's about making something intuitive, right? So that even if someone is not fully literate, they're able to use the device, and from there, they're able to make simple payments, right? And our example of what we've launched in markets around the world, and especially in India, as I gave you that example with that laundry shop owner again, he wasn't able to read or write. He's not able to read or write, but he is still able to, collect payments on his phone very simply and easily. So we believe in building simple use cases, intuitive user experiences that can make sense, and it's a continuous learning experience, right? Our first iteration of our products are not necessarily going to be the ones that stick. We have to continue to test and learn and do a lot of consumer research, and that's what we as technology companies feel like is a strength for us, is building user experiences that work.
So going a little bit deeper there, we have another question from the public who says, could you share with us your experience for reaching different segments, for example, elder people? And have you seen or how do you see the resistance to change in these populations?
I think kind of building on Uzma's answer, I think there is this baseline need for financial literacy. So while the user experiences that many of our companies built are very simple and very intuitive, I think when it comes to financial interactions or payments, there is a baseline need for financial literacy and an extra layer of trust that people need when it does involve their money. So I think for some of the populations that might not be as trusting of that, that is definitely on us and our partners to really think through how do we provide the right type of education in real time in the apps or in the products to really reach the right populations.
Then there, well, this question, what do you think about Codi and how could you integrate Codi with your models? I promise I didn't put it in.
I think you should ask Miguel.
Okay, I'll jump to the next one. So this is about learning from you. So this is a question that has challenged us. And I'm not sure that we will have a correct answer to this or a good answer to this, but there are rural areas in which probably there are some telecom problems in terms of outreach. Have you seen any solution to these types of problems elsewhere? So how do we reach these populations that do not necessarily have access to telecoms, to broadband telecommunication systems?
So one way we've thought about that is, you know, there are a lot of areas where there isn't consistent internet or telco access that limits use. One way we've kind of thought through this is partnering with some of our connectivity and telco access teams and the partners that they have out in the field and their telco partners to think through, you know, how should we think about rural areas? How could, you know, rural areas from the US to, you know, pick any country in the world. So I think, again, there is this need for partnerships like across different entities in those spaces and to actually tackle that problem together, because it can't be just an internet solution or just a new digital payment solution, but really have to think about what is that enabling environment.
Mm-hmm. Usma, so there's another question regarding European regulation. They're basically interested in the impact of the General Data Protection Regulation in terms of the payment operations in Europe. So could you explain us if that has had any effect on your operations?
So I have to say that I'm definitely not an expert in European regulation, you know, I think Europe is obviously on the forefront of trying to push for more data privacy, and GDPR is an example of that. But I can't comment any further on what I think of it overall, okay. But we're definitely complying with it, as do other companies need to do in Europe.
Okay, there's another one. Which are the main factors for Mexico to actually get this going very fast for the payment systems? Which do you think is the main element that we, so that we can really go fast in terms of adoption?
So I would say that first and foremost, there needs to be sort of alignment in the ecosystem, right? I mean, you've got, a Banco Mexico trying to push for realizing their vision, right? The vision of enabling all Mexicans to be able to quickly send and receive money at low cost. And that's a great vision, and you know, we are aligned with that as a tech company. I think the banks are all aligned with that, and obviously consumers and merchants are as well. So there's one thing which is the alignment on the vision, and the next is sort of alignment on how we want to get there. You asked a question about Codi. I think what you're trying to do with Codi also is simplifying the process, right? It's sort of one way of getting to simple and easy payments without having to memorize long numbers of the recipient's address that they need to send money to. So I think, it really is about the ecosystem coming together and realizing that, look, we're in this together, and it's good for Mexico in the long run. It's good for everyone in the ecosystem in the long run to work together and enable everyone to be able to use digital payments, rather than people sort of thinking about their own agenda and feeling like, this is not the right way forward.
So, Lina, a question regarding partnerships with different financial institutions. So we are really interested in knowing what is your perception regarding agnostic partnerships. So basically opening up and allowing anyone that can comply with their requirements to basically join into the game and probably join your platform to provide the services.
Yeah, I mean, that's one of the principles is thinking, you know, how we approach an open and inclusive platform. I think that can change country by country, whether there is a national rail like UPI in place or not. I also think different national rails have different characteristics. So what that means could be different. But our goal is definitely to try to have an open a platform as much as possible, while being cognizant of the integrations that still need to happen and the kind of partnerships that we need to put into place and how that can take time. So I think that is definitely like a guiding light for us, is to try to build that type of ecosystem and try to work with both industry and also the regulators to try to figure out how that works.
And one more question regarding, so you spoke a lot about cash and the quest in terms of generating services that can compete with cash. So for the settlement of a transaction, cash is a really efficient means of payment. So you go to the store and basically you just provide the bill and you're done. And the transaction is good and there's very low probability of fraud and so on. So, and on top of that, people perceive that cash payments are basically costless. So when we shift to an electronic payments realm, we have to do something like that. So we have to have people actually understanding that the payment is not costly for itself. But how can you manage to get this and then get sustainability in the long term? So how do you manage to bring people into the ecosystem and then get sustainability of all the players involved in this ecosystem?
Yeah, so I think there are a few different factors, right? I mean, cash is still king in many parts of the world because of what you said, right? It's easy to go and pay and be done. And for merchants, they get their money right away. But I think it's a matter of sort of educating both merchants and consumers who prefer to spend and be paid in cash. That cash is not actually free, right? We've interviewed consumers and done research around the world, including in Mexico, and we've talked to people who said, look, every morning we take our stash of cash and we put it in 6 different pockets so that if we get pickpocketed, only 1/6 of our cash is gone, right? And in fact, that was from someone in Mexico, actually. For merchants, right, it is about, you know, at the end of the day, they still have to sit and count their cash and they have to make sure that they don't get pickpocketed on their way back home, right? Forget about pickpocketing, it's even the overhead of managing that cash and counting and reconciling it and looking at their transaction history. None of that is available, or it's much harder to manage your transactions, to manage your spend, to see patterns if you're having to do it on paper, right? And so there is that element of overhead. In addition to that, you're not building credit history if you're paying in cash. So then if you're a merchant who sells, let's say, stationery, right, for schools that are opening, maybe you have a lot of sales in August and, you know, just before schools open, but what happens in sort of November, December when everybody's bought their papers and books for school? Then you have a dip in your sales. Right? And so how do you manage your working capital to be able to run your business? You may need a loan at some point. And if you don't have credit history, then you're not going to be able to get a loan very easily at favorable terms. And then you end up having to go to loan sharks. Same for consumers. And so building up credit history through these digital payments is actually essential for them to be able to get additional financial services from banks. So I think it's about educating consumers and educating merchants on the value of using digital payments. And for merchants, again, there is a concern, obviously, of sort of having digital payments and then having to pay taxes on payments that they otherwise collect in cash and may not necessarily have to pay taxes on, all of them across the, you know, and this is true for many small merchants across the world. But what we're seeing is that governments who are trying to displace cash are also working on sort of trying to build tax incentives so that there is that additional benefit in terms of accepting digital payments. It's not a hindrance for them.
So one general question that we have a couple of people asking is concerning cybersecurity challenges for this type of information flow. So personal information is very delicate, and then if you add on top of this your financial resources, it becomes really, really serious. So what have been your experiences in terms of cybersecurity elsewhere, and what are the main recommendations on that area?
Well, I'm definitely not a cybersecurity expert, but that is really part of the trust that we are trying to build is, you know, it's one thing, as you say, for someone's personal data to get out, but personal data on top of transaction data or other financial data is definitely a line that consumers are very conscious of not wanting to cross. So that's just part of how we think about, you know, everything from making sure that, you know, if there are card payments, that, you know, our partners and we, especially Facebook, Payments Inc. is PCI compliant. So thinking about everything from industry standards to how we can use kind of new innovative ideas to add to that is something we are constantly thinking about.
Great. Thank you very much. So we have lots of other questions, but I think we don't have enough time to go through them all. But I will hand them to you so that if you want, you can give your answer to us and we will share it with the public. Thank you very much. This has been a very enlightening conversation. Thank you.
Thank you.